He can share what his will is for us. Amen. Then the other thing is God made us for his pleasure. Now, if you are a Bible scholar and if you're one that will dig in the scriptures, I want to give you a few scriptures that will prove that. Psalm 35, 27, Psalm 149 and 4, and then Luke 12, 32, which is one of my favorites concerning this. The Bible says in Luke 12, 32, it tells us to fear not. Fear not, little children, for it is your Father's pleasure to give you the kingdom. His pleasure to give us the kingdom. So God takes pleasure in us. Amen. That's one of the things he does. He takes pleasures in his children. Then we also know, according to the scriptures, that God made us to worship him. That's why you will find that we cannot get away from worship. Whether you're a believer or not, worship is in you. I mean, it's in there. There used to be a commercial, I think it was a Ragu commercial, and people were asking in the commercial, do you have this in there? Is this ingredient? And the responder would keep saying, it's in there. Well, I can tell you, worship is in there. Whether you're born again or not, worship is in you. And the thing about being born again is that we find as born again, as believers, we learn how to worship the one that is the only one that is worthy of worship. Amen. And that's God our Father. That's why many people outside of Christ, they're searching and searching and searching and getting caught up in so many things. Why? Because we are innate worshipers. And if you don't worship God, you're going to worship something. You know, you're going to worship something. Some people will worship their children. Some people will worship their spouse. Some people worship things. Amen. And then some people worship crack. That's how people get caught up. Some people, but it's in us. We have to worship. But I tell you this, if we don't worship the one that put it in there, we'll never be fulfilled in our worship. We'll consistently be seeking something else to worship. And most of the time, people don't even know that that's what they're seeking after. Amen. God made us to be blessed. Even according to Genesis 1:28, you know, that word blessed in the text, in the context of this scripture, it means to be empowered to prosper. So God made us to be blessed. The Bible says he blessed us and he commanded us be fruitful. That means to be productive. We should never be folk that are just idle. I mean, doing nothing, going nowhere ever. Because God made us to be fruitful. He actually commanded us to be fruitful. And then God made us to have dominion. That means to dominate or walk in authority. I love it, love it, love it. Now, that's when we can honestly say God made us to be above only and not beneath. Above in our thinking, above in our doing. Amen. Because he put in us what it took for us to dominate, us to be to have dominion. Now, he did not intend for us to dominate one another, but he told us to dominate it, whatever it is. And whatever it comes between us and our Father, we need to dominate it. Whatever spirit will come between us and our Father, we need to dominate. We need to walk in authority over that thing. He also made us to replenish or procreate, to refill the earth with our own kind. You know, the Bible teaches us that every seed reproduces after its own kind. And now let me say this. Let me kind of digress to say this concerning that. You know, when God said that to Adam and Eve, when he spoke that concerning them, what he really meant, not just in the natural reproducing children, because he did mean that, but he also meant reproducing spiritually. Reproducing spiritually. And that's why it's so important that you make sure that you're walking in holiness and righteousness and that your relationship with the Father is what it should be. Because if you're not, you're going to still reproduce after your own kind. And if your kind is a monster, if you walk around messing with everybody, if you walk around being bitter towards folks, if you walk around just being plain mean. I read on somebody's Facebook page today their comment. They said, being mean in a Christian, that's an oxymoron. It's nowhere in the world you can be mean and be a Christian. You're like Christ. We never read anywhere where Christ was mean. Now, we did read where he got angry, but he was not mean. He was justified in that holy indignation, that holy anger. But, you know, we can't be mean folk, but so we don't dominate one another, but we dominate it, and we replenish and we reproduce after our own kind. And our own kind ought to be Christian. Our own kind ought to be Christ. You know, this is Christmas. You know, not Christmas. We don't change his name to suit Christmas, the season of Christmas, which is not even in the scripture. No, we don't. It's Christmas if it's going to be anything. Amen. And so we ought to be reproducing after our own kind. He also made us to subdue. Now, this word, I love this word especially because this word comes from a Hebrew word, rada. I like even the way it sounds, rada. You know, it kind of, to me, it connotates warfare. You know, now this is when I can get mad. When I go into war, I can get angry when I go into war. Amen. Because this word really, it means to tread down. It means to subjugate or to conquer. And I found this very interesting here in Genesis in the Garden of Eden that God would say to us, listen, this is how I made you to operate. I want you to subdue it. I want you to have dominion. I want you to rada. I want you to subjugate. I want you to tread down upon any joker that gets in your way. And I don't mean a natural person. I mean whatever spirit somebody operates out of that is contrary to the word of God that would try to get me off course in the things of God. So God has given me free license. He's given me freedom. And as a matter of fact, he has commanded me to tread down and subjugate and to conquer that thing that would, you know, would keep me from being who he called me to be and keep me from living out my divine destiny in the earth. Amen. But I find it very interesting that he would say this because here we are in the Garden of Eden. And if we're not savvy it scripturally, if we don't know how to go in and dig some more in the scriptures, we would think, why would God do this? Why would he say tread down upon? Why would he say subjugate? Why would he say conquer if there's no enemies in the garden? Everything in the garden is subject to Adam and Eve. The Bible tells us that Adam was allowed to name every animal. Now, I don't believe God allowed him to name the animals and then he had to fear the animals. No, you know, he had the authority over all the animals. They understood who he was. They understood his position in creation. Amen. God made the animals intelligent enough to know who Adam and Eve were, what their lot was in the garden. Amen. The power that they had. Amen. And so I believe that God said tread down upon. He gave this dominion because he knew without a doubt that we would have an enemy, that the enemy of our soul, in fact, was already in the earth realm lurking about. As the scripture says, I believe in 1 Peter, it talks about the enemy, the devil, walks about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. So God knew the day was going to come when the enemy showed up in the garden. So he equipped us. See, this is God's original plan, that we would be above and not beneath, that we would be even as he is in the earth, that we would not have to be afraid of anything or anybody. Amen. And that we operated out of in his image and after his likeness, that we operated just like our daddy in the earth. Amen. So he didn't set us up to be knocked down. He didn't set us up to be punked by the devil. He gave us everything we needed right there in the garden. Amen. To never fall prey to the dirty devil. Listen, you're listening to Pastor Tracy, A Time in the Word at intellectualradio.com. We're going to be right back, but I want you to stay right there. I want you to remember right where I left off at about us having dominion over the dirty, dumb devil. Hallelujah.